lives have gone astray.
I want you to open your Bible to Philippians chapter 4. You can go to Psalms, I guess. It's pretty good. Philippians chapter 4. I think, as it looks now, next week, those of you who have been through Bible school, you'll get to hear it again. But we're going to start a series on blood covenants starting next Sunday.
Amen.
Okay. We will have a few services that deal with blood covenant. Because if you do not understand blood covenant, the Word of God is blind to you.
Yes. Right.
Okay, it's askewed at best. Once you understand blood covenant, because really it says Old and New Testament, but it really should read Old Covenant and New Covenant.
Yeah.
Because the covenant's that. This is where a lot of churches get messed up and can't figure it out. They say, well, he said, I'm the Lord, I change not. You're absolutely right. But the covenants have changed and the terms of agreement between God and man have changed. That's why God isn't wiping out cities with hurricanes and pouring out judgment and wrath on people, because the covenants have changed. And once you understand that you are a blood covenant man, it will make you approach God boldly, and you'll feel like there's nothing you can't do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. One guy that I love to listen to, I got to see him. He's friends with the guy that mentored me. He's worldwide. You would know him if I said his name. But he made a statement years ago that stuck with me. He said, when you understand these things like blood covenant and what the blood has done and who the Holy Spirit is in you and the power of the Word of God and what resides in you, he said, you can swing over hell on a cornstalk and spit in the devil's face. There is something about understanding blood covenant and who we are in Christ that causes a boldness to rise.
Praise the Lord. That's right. Amen.
In the early church, one of the early leaders of the church, in the book of Acts, he prayed for this. He prayed, may your servants receive boldness.
Yes. Amen.
That was his prayer, that we receive boldness.
Yes.
If you haven't noticed, the world is trying to quiet the voice of the church.
Amen.
Let me tell you this. One of my favorite scriptures, which I have about ingrained in you guys, and no, it's not Mark 16. Another one that I have just drilled into you is Hosea 4:6. Anybody know what that says? Yeah, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. And that word destroy, one implication in the Hebrew means that their mouths have become silent.
Yes.
Yeah, God said, my people's mouths have become silent for a lack of knowledge. See, once you understand the Word of God, how to use it, who you are in Christ, it will cause your mouth to boldly declare some things on the side. But a lack of knowledge causes us to be quiet. We think, well, if it's God's will, it'll happen. No, God's will won't happen until you get in line with God's will.
Amen.
Amen. That's when God's will happen.
That's good, Pastor. That's so good. Amen.
Bob.
All right, Philippians chapter 4. I had a dream last night. I was going to do something else. This is for real. Come on, guys. It's not the footprints, but the trench. You think about that one, Marty. I get them with that in other places. I had a dream, and they're on the edge of their seats, and I'm like, oh, wow, really?
Come on, guys.
But I really had a dream last night concerning the church. In my dream, my children had gone to the refrigerator, and Kelly was in there, and they had opened it up, and all the food was spoiled. And so when I woke up, I asked the Lord, well, what does this mean? Because I know when the Lord's talking to me.
Yeah.
And here's what he told me. If we're not careful in this church and other churches that get taught very well, do you guys agree you get taught well?
Yeah.
Some of you have experienced victory because you know how to use the Word of God.
Amen.
You know who you are in Christ. You know how to fight. You got a backbone of steel. You won't let go. But if you're not careful, all the knowledge that is imparted to you, you can sit on it and become fat on the Word of God.
Yes.
Amen. When God gave the children of Israel manna, he said, gather enough for one day.
Yes.
And you try to hold it in the pots, it all went rotten. They couldn't use it. So here's the thing, you are the manna pots. This is the bread of life come down from heaven.
Amen.
And if I just fill you with knowledge, and there's another danger that can happen if I don't teach you right. See, I can impart all this theology, all this knowledge, and all this truth. And Paul warned us, he said, be careful because knowledge will cause pride to rise up in you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, a lot of people know a lot of things, but their character is not in line with what they know. Therefore, they're puffed up in pride and they hurt people.
Amen.
Well, why does that happen? Well, you don't force the Word of God down somebody's throat.
Amen.
You don't sit bigger and argumentative to it. Listen now. And the reason I'm telling you, because I've been at every stage of development that every one of you are in right now.
Yes.
I have been through this thing from the beginning. I had a head full of knowledge, but not enough wisdom, man. I was dangerous. I was telling everybody how it was and why they were wrong and how they were wrong. I've learned now that there's a song that says there's nothing a little love can't fix. There's nothing too big that the love of God cannot fix.
Amen.
And so if I'm not careful, you guys will get fat on the Word of God and stagnant, and you will have a head full of knowledge but never do anything with it.
Right.
And on the second hand, you can become full of pride. And the reason pride is dangerous is that God resists the proud.
Amen.
Wow, now listen, if God's resisting you, you got some problems. And the Bible says this, that a haughty spirit goes before a fall and pride goes before destruction. Yeah. Yep. Prideful people are on their way to problems.
Yes.
You should write that down, that's good.
Right there.
Pride will lead you into a problem, okay? So if I'm not careful, I got to balance you out with the knowledge that you get. Some of you have come in and told me that it would take both hands and then some to count the number of people, and what an honor. I think the men who poured into me have come to me over the months in this last year and said, Pastor David, I have learned more coming to your church and your school in just a few months than I have in X amount of years in the church world.
Right. Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That is absolutely amazing. What an honor. That's a testimony to the men of God who were patient with me in all my garbage and all my stages. The things that my pastor gave me at one time, it caused pride to rise up in me. I call it the teenage stage. You know, you have baby Christians. That's when you're a baby Christian, you can open the Bible and God will lead you to a scripture. And you're like, wow, that's amazing. And God just does all these things.
Yeah.
And then later, when you grow, He quits doing that. And you think there's something wrong. No, He's telling you it's time to grow up now.
Right.
Now it's time for you to search me out. It's time to stretch your spiritual muscles.
That's right.
People say, well, I feel like God's far away. Yeah, He's on the other side coaxing you to walk to Him.
Amen.
So there's the baby stage. And then there's that teenage stage where we get rebellious against the spiritual authority of the house.
Right, yeah.
I remember sitting there thinking after a few years, knowing I was called to preach, and my pastor would be preaching, I thought, I can preach that good. Why don't he let me up there some? At least give me a Sunday night. I've been sitting here 2 years, and I preached one time. Man, they ought to get together and let me take over this place. I could do as good a job as him. Hey, hello.
Come on, guys.
Sitting there thinking, man, why don't he see what's inside of me,
right,
man?
Right.
I'm sitting there all sold up thinking, when's he going to recognize how powerful I am? I mean, he knew how powerful I was. He just knew at the stage of my development I was dangerous.
Amen.
He said, we need to work some things out. He can hot shot. He did. Remember this, man, Holland, we used to have 3-day crusades at Christmas time in 2 or 3 different cities. We'd go set up a tent, we would give food and clothes and toys for 3 days. We bought all the stuff, donations came in, and we'd go preach, and he'd let me have the middle night. But he always made me set up the tents and carry the groceries. I remember one night in particular, it was my night to preach. It had rained, it had snowed, and it was filthy, nasty outside. David, you need to go unload that truck full of turkeys. I'm in my church clothes. I'm preaching, man. Listen, he wasn't the kind of guy that asked you. He just told you, and he said, yes, sir, and did it. Or he didn't do nothing else. And so I'm trudging through the mud, the snow, and I'm carrying turkeys thinking, wow, what a way to treat the preacher. That's where I was. my part, let me tell you this. It was the worst sermon I've ever preached in my life. Horrible. I was standing up there thinking, I wish this guy had shut up. I mean, it was bad. It was boring. It didn't make sense. I went all over the place. I didn't take over the church. I can't even preach in a tent. But God honored his word and the faithfulness that night. Some like 34 people got born again.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
And that night, this is what he taught me. It is never about you, hush up. It's about the power and the integrity of my word.
Amen.
When I get done with you, I will promote you. Until then, let me shake you.
Yes.
I said, wow.
Wow.
Looking at my muddy shoes and 34 people crying and receiving Jesus.
Wow.
Knowing it was the worst sermon I ever preached. It's horrible. Wow.
Man.
Let God shape you. Let him develop you. Man, we got something beautiful here at 29.
Yeah,
that's right. Amen.
I would push up against any big church pound for pound.
Amen. Amen.
We're going to change this city, I promise you.
Amen.
We are getting ready to reach out into Oklahoma here in a few months.
Yes, sir.
We're going to reach a hand over there. Years ago, Lord spoke to Kelly. We were driving. She said, baby, we're going to do work in Oklahoma. I said, you don't hear the Lord, sissy. Yeah, I know her. I said, baby, you're not hearing the Lord. That's wrong. I said, God has not spoken to me about Oklahoma. He would speak to me, wouldn't he? Listen, you guys are the only ones that have shortcomings, okay? Don't be so hard on yourself. All right, we're all in stages of development. When we quit developing is when we reach the throne of God.
Amen.
Amen. And I told her, baby, you are not hearing the Lord. We're supposed to be here and bring this solve. This is what we're going to do, change Arkansas. Bring revival and change the shape of the church. And she said, well, baby, just listen. Well, guess what? He started connecting us. All the people he started connecting us with were from Oklahoma.
Yeah.
You know, we go to Oklahoma and we have great success over there. That's how we met Christy and ended up meeting Matt and the Chambers and I don't know who else. And now I have a heart to do something in Oklahoma.
Praise the Lord.
So you did hear the Lord. Philippians 4:6. I want to talk to you. This will help. Listen, this will help balance you. How many of you really want the unsearchable riches of the kingdom?
Amen.
Here's what people forget, so I will keep reminding all of you. When I came to God, I'd been homeless in the streets for 5 years. I was not raised in church. I stumbled into the church to try to use them, okay? I didn't know the Word of God. People have asked me over the years, how do you get the things that you get? I'm getting ready to teach you, okay? Because you get taught here very well, don't you?
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Anybody that gets up behind this pulpit imparts something good to you, some eternal value to you. But in your Christian life, that is not enough. I told you, you will sit there and you will get fat on the Word of God and you will get puffed up with knowledge, okay?
Amen.
This year, the last year, we have been really working on character here at 2911.
Yes.
This is what Jesus said. He said, the world will know you belong to me, not by the way you speak in tongues. Hallelujah. We believe in that. We practice that. Not the way you cast out devils. Not the way you preach so good, but he said, the world will know that you belong to me by the way that you love one another.
Amen.
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 You see, but if our character is not intact here, we'll be like every other church. We'll become political. We'll become factioned. It'll be this family against that family, and that's not going to happen here. We will love each other, and we will become the family of God that He has ordained in Acts chapter 2.
Amen.
It starts Wednesday night.
That starts on Wednesday night. I remember this little plaque that said, the family that prays together stays together.
Amen.
Let me tell you what will happen. Well, now you're ahead in my sermon.
Oh.
So this will balance you out. This will keep you from getting prideful, and it will keep you from being stagnant. Okay? Philippians 4, verse 6, it says, be careful for nothing or anything. Don't worry about stuff. Anybody worried about stuff in here? Don't raise your hand.
Okay.
You look like the Feed the Children commercial for $1 a day.
Healing service.
Philippians 4:6. Don't worry about anything, but in everything, I'm going to say everything.
Everything.
By prayer and supplication. supplication. Now look at this, with thanksgiving.
Wow, that's good.
Then he says, let your request be made known unto God. The Word of God tells us, first of all, don't worry about things.
Amen.
Some of you here are record-breaking Guinness Book warriors. Now, how do you know? Because I was that guy for a long time. I knew all the things you guys knew. But we have shared with you, man, I've worried about money and finances all the time. It was so bad that it would cause me and my wife to fight if we went to the grocery store. No, I don't think we can do that. It might be $6 over our budget. We better not, babe. I would sit, now listen, you guys can ask her, I would sit 2 or 3 days before my paycheck. There's nothing wrong with having a budget. We have a budget, we budget our money for the things we need to do, but it's not okay to be so worried and consumed with fear that is what drives you when you do something. I've had to learn this over the years. Listen, this is what God said. How many of you believe the promises of God are true? Okay, well, why worry?
Right.
It's not like I promised you. The Creator of the universe promised you this. And He said, I will provide for you. In the book of Exodus, He says, God is the God who blesses our bread and water and takes sickness and disease from the midst of us. Those are promises. Philippians somewhere else, He said, I will supply all your need according to my riches and glory by Christ Jesus. One man explained it like this, God doesn't meet your need according to your need.
That's right.
He meets it according to His riches and glory.
Hallelujah.
That's like going to Him and say, God, I need my light bill paid and I need food. And He said, well, here's another 200 for you. Go help somebody and enjoy the rest of it.
Amen.
That's what it means to get your needs met according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Then He says, when we come to Him and approach Him in prayer, that we are to add thanksgiving to that.
Amen.
If you go back and look at your prayer life and how you approach God, I think thanksgiving a lot of times is the missing ingredient.
Yes.
What are you thanking for? Well, it's like David when he went to fight Goliath. He said, I fought the bear, I fought the lion, and now I'm going to whip you, big boy.
Woo!
In other words, he said, I have experienced victories in God.
Yes.
I know what it's like. God will never leave me and He will never forsake me.
Amen.
And he says, so you running your mouth, big boy, you're nothing. All I need is a rock.
Amen.
All I need is one rock and that will shut your mouth, devil. Do you need one rock, one nugget of revelation from the Word of God? Remember, my people are silenced and made utterly quiet from a lack of knowledge.
Wow.
Number one thing you need to do to the devil is talk to him.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, I'm not saying ask what spirit this is. What's your name?
No.
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about put him in his place.
Amen.
Get that rock of the Word of God, that nugget, and sling it dead at him. You know what?
It's glory.
The one thing Satan doesn't like, he doesn't care if you cry.
Right.
He doesn't care if we're hurt. He doesn't care about any of that. But what he cannot withstand is the Word of God slung at him with somebody who knows how to sling a stone.
Amen.
When you learn who you are, see, the sling God gave us is our mouth. And the number one thing Satan wants to do is to silence you. And if he can't silence you, he will put so many circumstances, so many problems, and squeeze you so hard that the words of your mouth are surrounding your circumstantial problem and your worry.
All right.
And you cannot get free of anything talking the problem.
Amen.
And understand this, people are not your problem. It says we war against not flesh and blood.
Amen.
He uses flesh and blood, but he said, but here's what Jesus said, when Satan uses that flesh and blood to hurt you, your job is to pray for them, to love them, and to give them things.
Yes. Amen.
Why? Because that will keep your heart free from harboring bitterness.
Amen.
See, when we mess up, God, it says that His goodness causes me to repent.
Right.
In other words, He will keep lavishing the love of the Spirit on me until I say, man, I have wronged. churches anymore.
Oh, come on.
And it's like I told y'all, when somebody does something bad to me, what I've learned over the years, I was talking to Sister Beth this morning, I've been treated bad in the church world, believe it or not.
Yes, yes, you have.
I mean, I have been treated real bad. Kelly and I have been places and pastors wouldn't even shake my hand. I was invited to go preach there, and the pastor of the church would not even shake my hand. He just looked at me like I was garbage.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
I've been done bad, and that's just one out of a bunch.
Yeah.
You understand? But here's what you have to do. You have to learn. The Bible says in Mark 4, I believe it is, that we have to keep a conscience void of offense.
Dear man.
What does that mean? We have to understand that when somebody wrongs me, one man says it this way, you can't allow somebody's sin against you to produce sin in you. How do you keep your conscience void of offense? The minute that I'm wronged, I don't lash out at that person. I don't tell 50 people what they've done to me. I go to the Lord and say, Father, this brother and sister in Christ has hurt me deeply. I don't know what to do, but God, whatever I need to do to fix this gap, Lord, show me how to fix it. And Jesus said, you pray for them, you love them, and you give to them.
Yes.
Come on, something will free you of somebody that's hurt you deeply to give them something. And tell them, hey, I love you, and God loves you in spite of yourself. Or you can tell them what I tell people, you better be glad Jesus loves you because nobody else likes you. And see, if we would work, listen, I impart knowledge to you. I impart knowledge to you, not just so we can be the church that knows all the stuff, but so that we can actively work the Word of God and that they can see the difference in our church members and this church than any other church. Then when they come in here, I've had people come in here and say, you know what? I've never felt welcome in a church till I walked in there. I feel totally welcome there.
Huh,
you must be among family and friends. When you have a problem, this body should draw together. If we have a problem in the body, we need to fix it quickly or it's going to ripple and it's going to hurt us. This is what I've told people, and I've told you this here, but those of you who don't know, if I start giving you lots of stuff, I either love you very much or you tick me off. I think I gave Brother Russell some, and he said, did I make him mad? If I just let you sit here and soak in the truth and the knowledge and the theology, but never push you to work the Word of God, I'm doing you a disservice.
Yes.
Well, how do you work the Word of God? Philippians 4 said, well, don't be anxious for anything. Don't worry. You got to learn how to answer worry and to tell the devil, this isn't mine. This isn't how it's going to play out.
Amen.
This will help you. The Bible says, does it not, that Satan is the father of all lies?
Amen.
This is what kills me. Spirit-filled, Bible-believing Christians come to me crying, you know what the devil's been telling me all week? Yeah, lies. If his mouth was moving, it was a lie, partner. And when he tells me, listen, let me tell you, this church was born out of prayer. I'm going to talk to you today about the importance of prayer. The churches that we have built from the ground up, and Pastor, we start, it's in living room with we start.
Yes.
We be starts.
You got it, brother.
We start in a living room with a few people, and it always ends up growing in this life. Because the Word of God is like a seed that multiplies. You can put concrete over it, but it's like grass. It's going to sprout up. People all over the world are hungry for the truth of God.
Amen.
And the number one thing we need to be doing as a body, listen, this is where your character and things will get shaped. And the theology helps you. It teaches you how to battle the devil. Well, you know what the devil's been telling me all week? Yes, lies. Well, Brother David, I don't know what to do. Rejoice.
Amen.
Why would you rejoice? Well, listen, if Satan's telling you you're never going to make it, it's a lie. It means you're right on the verge of breakthrough.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, he told me once my kids had never changed, and I bought into it for a minute, and then I figured out he's the father of all lies.
That's right.
He told me, sir, he was telling me before, that church in Greenwood ain't going to take off. You've missed God.
Wow. Yeah.
Huh? Then you miss God. You got eight people in a storefront. You miss God. And then I said, wait a minute, you're the father of all lies. It must mean we're going to explode in grief. And so Kelly and I changed our confession and started telling him, you know, we're going to explode in Greenwood.
That's right.
Yeah, the people of God that are hungry for the Word of God, we're going to blow up in Greenwood.
Amen.
That way you have lit my fuse and you made me angry. Philippians 4:6, don't worry about stuff. Stop worrying. How do you worry? You meditate the Word of God.
That's right.
You get a promise of God for that situation, and instead of worry, you mull that promise over and over and over and over. All meditation is worrying in reverse.
Yes.
Those of you who have been career warriors, if you replace that worry with the Word of God, your life will radically change. It will be different. There have been times in mine and my wife's life that you think we float around on the cloud and play a harp and people just come to the house and fall on the floor because the presence of God is so strong. No, it didn't work that way. We have had times in our life, in our personal life, just the last couple years, where it looked like all hope was lost.
Yes.
Like the ship was sinking, man. And we had a minute, we sat on the couch and we cried together very hard. Because we're hurt, devastated by something. And then we looked at each other and said, well, we know what we have to do.
Right.
We can either
sit
and camp and whine and cry about this thing, or we can get up and praise. So we turned on praise music. We started to dance before the Lord, and we worshiped, and we got the Word of God, and that situation changed within a couple of weeks. See, but you got to get the worry out of your life. The only way to get worry out of your life is to replace it with the Word of God.
Amen.
You guys know Jeremiah 29:11 by now. It says, I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord, right?
Yes.
Apart from prayer, you will never access the plan of God.
That's right. That's good.
Let me take a drink of water while you think about that.
That's good, Pastor.
Apart from prayer, you will never access the plan of God for your life.
That's right.
Amen.
See, God doesn't just drop these things on you like ripe apples out of a tree. It doesn't work that way. He says, in the day when you seek me, you seek me.
Yeah, that's right.
In other words, I came after you at your worst.
Yes.
I came where you were and you were lost and hopeless and undone. And I found you where you were. I picked you up. See, the story of the Good Samaritan is actually Jesus with us. Everybody else passed you by in your garbage. They left you wounded. They left you hurt. They turned a blind eye and a deaf ear to you.
Amen.
And the Master came by and he said, I'm going to take you bloody, bruised, and wounded, and I'm going to set you on my own donkey, and I'm going to pay for your healing until it's done.
Amen.
Thank
you, God.
And he said, I came after you in your worst state that you could ever be. Everybody else passed you by. Nobody wanted you, but I did.
Yes.
And he said, but now that I have found you, it's your turn to come and find me.
Yes.
He said, how many of you want to know the plan of God for your life, really, what you're supposed to be doing personally? It won't come apart from prayer. See, there are a lot of dynamics that go into the Christian life. And let me tell you something. The Bible says this. To whom much is given, much is required.
Amen.
To whom much is given, much is required. What does that mean? Here is a healthy Christian life. Fasting, praying, giving, church attendance, and involved in the things of the kingdom of God to keep things going.
Amen.
Now, well, that seems like a lot. To whom much is given, much is required. Wow. You got to find out the things God wants you involved in and the things He don't. Huh? We got a food pantry ministry now. We're getting ready to feed the homeless.
Yes.
If that's what you want to be a part of, pray. Access the plan of God and see what you're supposed to do. Are you supposed to be a part of that? We've got the children's ministry. It's really starting to take off. You see the number of children we have now?
Yeah.
See, when we have the right people in the right places, God will bless it and cause it to expand.
Amen.
Well, what am I supposed to do, Pastor David? I know some things that some of you are supposed to do, but I don't know all of it. That's your job to access the plan of God, but it will only come through prayer.
Thank you.
A man that helped shape me in the ministry named Pastor Ron McKee, who's very influential in my life, he gave these statistics when I graduated Bible school, and he's real avid on the teaching of prayer. He said that the average pastor prays 7 minutes a week. The average pastor prays 7 minutes a week, and that's across the board. That means some of them don't even pray. Huh?
I said, that's why the churches, the generals in the shape that they're in.
That's what I was about to say. Thank you, Brother Calvin.
Sorry about that.
No, that's why the church at large is the way it is. That's why the majority of Christians in the church do not and will not pray. Why? Everything in the kingdom of God, it works from this pulpit out to you. If your pastor doesn't have an importance for prayer, prayer is not important in the church. But what have I shared with you guys out of Matthew? Jesus said, my house shall be called not a house of program, but a house of prayer. Should we have programs in the church? We certainly should. If they are born out of the arena of prayer. We don't do things just to do things. Everything we do here has been prayed and it has been birthed from the arena of prayer. Everything in your life will be birthed from the avenue of prayer.
Yes.
Everything in your life.
Amen.
Man, we have built 4 churches. Kelly and I have built 2 of them from the ground up. And the foundation is always birthing it through prayer.
Yes, sir. That's right.
Everything has to be birthed through prayer.
Yes.
Now listen, a lot of people come to me and say, well, I don't know how to pray, Brother David. Start where you're at.
Amen.
If all you know is now I lay me down to sleep, pray it with your heart and God will honor it. And then over years, over time, months and weeks, you will get skillful in prayer. You know why the church needs to learn how to pray? Because James said the only reason we don't have is because we don't ask. In other words, he said that the things you don't have in your life that God promised you are because you are not praying for them. And then when you pray for them, he said you ask amiss, desiring to consume it on your own lusts. And we need to understand when God answers prayer. It says in 2 Corinthians 9 that God will give you seed for your sowing and bread for your eating. And when money and goods and things come in, you got to ask God, is this my bread or is this my seed? In other words, God, is this for me or has somebody else been asking you? And since I am a giver, Lord, show me what I'm supposed to do with it. This is what I've learned over the years. Even if I don't need something and somebody wants to give it to me, I take it because it will eventually somebody is praying for that very thing.
That's right.
I don't refuse anything anybody gives me. Because I'm a giver, man.
Right.
And eventually, here's how it works. If you become a giver, God will send people across your path. You remember what I read? That house of Stephana? Man, they got addicted to doing things for folks.
That's beautiful.
Yeah. Man, it becomes an addiction, man. There's something beautiful. Joy will be released into your life. If you want the joy and the fullness of God, go do something for somebody.
Yes.
Yeah, joy, well, there's something powerful in that. The plan of God is accessed by prayer. That's it. He said the average pastor prays about 7 minutes a week. Every Christian that I will add, do you believe prayer changes things? Yeah, I do. I believe that. But rarely do they pray. Rarely do they pray. Now, I'm not getting on you, but I want to ask you this. Think about it. Think about your Christian life the last month. How much time have you spent with God in prayer? How much time? Huh? Here's the saddest thing to me. The church says, boy, they're prayer warriors. In other words, they pick up your slack because you won't pray. There's always something happening for that guy, but not for me. That guy prays.
Right.
See, we shouldn't have prayer warriors in church. We should just have a praying church that are full of warriors for the kingdom. That's what we should have. Well, he sure is a prayer warrior. You mean he's been obedient to the call of God. Listen, this was instilled in me. I think about 1999, and I have never let go of this. This man said to me when he gave my diploma, the greatest call that you could ever answer, David, is the call to pray.
Yes, right.
It's a call to pray. Just pray. Every revival that has ever happened in the world, it came through the avenue of prayer. If we are not a praying church, we will not experience what God has set aside for us.
That's right.
Amen. If you are not a praying Christian, you will never, ever, never experience the fullness that God has set aside for you. And I don't know how to pray, Brother David. Well, listen, the highest form of praying is praying the Word of God back to Him.
Yes,
but the purest form of praying is from your heart, even if you don't know how to pray. That's the purest, most sincere prayer in the world. Father, help me. I don't know what to do.
Amen.
God, I need you right now. The angels snap to attention and say, what do we need to do?
Right.
If you could understand this, the angels are sitting at ready. They're at your disposal. We need to teach about the ministry of angels. They go. Listen, here's how I pray. Angels, you go and you surround them. It says in Jeremiah. That the angels listen to the Word of God. And then it says, in, I think it's 1 Peter or 2 Peter, one of the two. It says that the angels are servants for the heirs of salvation.
Yes.
Now, if they listen to the Word of God and they're here to serve me, then I need to pray the Word of God and disperse the angels to go work the Word of God.
Amen.
See, in the book of Daniel, he said, I heard you when the angel came. He said, you were heard the first time you prayed, but there was enemy resistance sent to withstand me. It took me 21 days to get to you.
Wow.
That's why some of us that have been praying, it seems like forever we can't figure out what's happening, what's going on, why don't I have it? Here's insight from the Word of God. The enemy has dispatched a force against the angel to stop your promise and the fulfillment of it. My people become silent for a lack of knowledge. Time and circumstances kill you. We start full of faith and fire. We're speaking, we're confessing, we're praying, and we're believing. And one little storm and we give up.
Right.
The angels disperse and they go back, waiting on ready. Maybe next time, David. I've been fighting this battle for you for 15 years and you're going to give up now? We were almost there.
Well, we were almost there. That's the word.
And we were almost there and you gave up. You need to pray.
Amen.
The greatest call that you could ever answer is a call to pray. Listen, you got to have a secret place.
Amen.
Something, somewhere. I don't care if it's the shower, the bathroom, your living room, or your bed. There needs to be a place where you make it sacred and you meet with the Holy Spirit. See, when you pray, you should take a pen and paper with you and expect to hear from God.
Amen.
And if you don't hear right then, believe me, as you go, you will start to hear the voice of God.
Yes.
The Bible says this. Jesus said in the book of John that my sheep know my voice.
Amen.
You know how many people that I've heard, well, I don't know if it's God, I don't know if it's me. Here's my advice. Spend more time in prayer and then you will get used to hearing the voice of God and you will know the leading of the Holy Spirit beyond the shadow of a doubt.
Amen.
Go to Daniel chapter 11. Is this all right this morning?
Yes.
Hope I'm helping you. Daniel chapter 11. And we'll go to verse 32 and I'll cover two other scriptures and I'll let you go home. If we do not answer the call to pray in this church, we will become unbalanced.
Yes, amen.
We will become full of pride, or we will become stagnant and not motivated on the Word of God. Daniel 11:32, it says this, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flattery. Now, here's the part I want to focus on. But the people that do know their God, that do know their God, shall be strong and do exploits. Well, brother, I just don't think I can go on. The Bible says those that know their God shall be strong.
Yes.
Then it says, and do exploits. What's an exploit? Look it up. It's a great and mighty miraculous deed. But he said you'll only get to that level when you know your God. That word know there is like the intimacy between a husband and wife. In other words, when you go before Him, there is nothing hidden. You don't try to hide your motives.
Right.
You don't hide who you are or what you've done or what you're currently doing.
Amen.
They that know their God shall be... Well, brother, I just don't feel like I got any strength. Well, then you need to reacquaint yourself with the Mighty One that lives in you.
Amen.
As He says, you shall be strong. In other words, when you close the chambers of that door with the Lord, those things that are done in secret will be rewarded openly.
Yeah.
It wasn't here, but I think when we were in the storefront, I told you the purpose of the secret place and knowing God and meeting with Him is to get impregnated with a godly vision. And you can tell a woman that's pregnant, you don't know everything she's done, but you know she has done something. You understand there was something done in private to cause something to show outwardly.
Yes.
And this is what God's saying. If you spend private, intimate time with Me, the world around you will see that there is something different about you. They'll know that you've been
Amen.
With Me.
Amen.
Why isn't our church strong in doing exploits? The body as a whole, not here, but the universal body doesn't pray.
Yep.
Prayer is reserved for when they're in trouble or they need something.
Right, right.
But prayer was designed to build intimacy between you and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
In fact, your prayer life, it should get to this point that you become conscious of the Holy Spirit walking with you.
Yes. Amen. Yes.
You become conscious of His presence wherever you are. Why? Because wherever you are, God wants to use you in that place.
That's right.
Wherever you are, God wants to use you in that place. Now go to Acts chapter 4. Stay with me a couple minutes.
Amen.
Read verse 31. Is that where I want to start? Start in verse 29. We just talked about this. Acts 4:29. This is the early church praying. How many of you know the early church had a lot of persecution going on?
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, when you're getting threatened and you're getting squeezed, believe me, you'll pray.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What Satan sends to destroy us will actually cause us to run to the arms of God if we react correctly, if we respond correctly.
Right, right. That's the key.
Acts 4, verse 29, now they were all gathered together to pray. And it says, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. In other words, look at the problem, Father. You see the problem. Grant unto your servants with all boldness that they may speak. Everybody say, speak.
Speak.
That they may speak thy word. Remember, Satan's number one goal is to get your mouth quiet where the word of God doesn't come out. Or to get you speaking all your circumstances so you fail anyway.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
Listen, God's aware of the circumstance.
Yes, amen.
Can I just give you a little hint, and this may or may not help you, and it may make you upset. But all the people that you're telling all your problems and circumstances to can't fix it and can't help you or it would have been done.
That's right. That's right.
Did I say that again?
Yes. Say it again.
All the people, and really what you're doing is you're tainting them and you're poisoning them.
Amen.
That's good. Yeah.
Because you are feeding negativity into their minds, their soul, and into their spirit.
Yes.
And now I have become silent because now you have filled me with your problem and your circumstance and your worries and you're ugly about somebody. And now guess what? I'm probably going to tell my wife. And now all of a sudden we got this thing. Whatever it is, see, it's better. The Bible says, where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord.
Amen.
That's okay to share with your brother and sister beside me a little prayer, but it's not okay to take 20 people with your problems.
Amen.
That's right.
Do you understand?
Yes. Yes.
That's how churches get into men because their pastors haven't taught them to be restrained with what they speak.
Amen.
See, here's part of prayer, which we were talking about this morning, me and Beverly. Here's another part of prayer. It's to teach you how to get quiet and listen.
Amen.
The Bible says be slow to speak. Quick to listen. The art of listening is lost in the church today.
Yes.
And listen, know about churches like this? There are other churches like this. Do you know that? We are not the only one. But people that go to churches like this, they get filled with the knowledge and they're excited about the word, but they won't let you get a word in edgewise. And then there are those who are so filled with worry and ugly and consumed with problems, you can't get a word in edgewise. In fact, if they do let you get a word, they formulated four sentences ahead of you.
Amen.
Wow. Okay. See, part of prayer is to teach you how to listen. See, when you get in prayer, you're in the presence of God, and there comes a time in prayer when you stop talking and you start listening.
Right.
Remember, we're all looking for the plan of God. We want the will of God. You will never access it beyond prayer.
Amen.
And then he said, with thanksgiving, in other words, you raise up and you thank him because it's already done.
That's right.
You thank him for what he has done, you thank him what he's going to do, and you thank him for what he's doing right now.
Right.
See, the things in my life aren't exactly where I want them, but thank God they weren't where they were.
Thank
God. My God.
That's right.
Oh, that makes me feel good. That makes me want to go another day. No warrants on me.
Amen.
I got desires in my heart that haven't been fulfilled yet, but I'm not going to sit camp on that. I'm going to enjoy that. I killed the bears. I killed the lion.
Woo.
And big boy, I'm coming after you. I'm coming after you. Do you understand? David went to Goliath. He said, Goliath said, you guys know the story. And then he slung the rock. Goliath didn't have anything else to say to David anymore. You see what I'm saying? If he can silence you or get your mouth full of complaint, you should do a study, all of you, especially Bible school students. It's your homework for Friday. Go do a study on murmuring and complaining. See, you as a Christian in your personal life, you will miss the will and the destiny of God. You murmur and complain, you will miss the will and the destiny of God. Why? Because he says, I want you to hush and listen. He didn't say complain about your problems. He said, bring them to the throne of grace and together we will solve it. He said, let me know what your problem is. Tell me your problem, and together I will give you wisdom, and together we will fix this thing. You access heaven, and I will enter earth, and together we'll fix it.
Praise the Lord.
I wish I could fix all of your problems, but I can't.
Amen. That's right.
You know what I'm doing? I'm working out my own salvation with fear and trembling. I love you. I'm here for you. But whatever you're going through, chances are I've been through it, or I'm going through it, or I will go through it. But Acts 4:31, verse 30 now, it says, by stretching forth your hand to heal. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes, that was beautiful.
And that signs and wonders may be done by the name of the Holy Child Jesus. That's a good prayer for our church, isn't it?
Yes.
And 31, listen, it said, when they, everybody say they.
They.
See, there's personal prayer that builds intimacy, and then there's corporate prayer that accesses the power of heaven for a body.
Yes.
It says, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken. Wouldn't that be good on a Wednesday night to have to hold the pulpit because the presence of God, this place is shaking?
Yes.
That'd be all right.
That's awesome.
And then when they, the corporate body, they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. Now, I like this. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Why? Because they gathered together corporately as a body, and they prayed, and God has said they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and with boldness.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
There's something powerful that comes out of personal prayer, and there's something powerful that comes out of corporate prayer. Hallelujah. And they spoke the word of God with boldness. And the multitude of them, verse 32, that believed were of one heart and of one soul. In other words, the Holy Spirit, in that place of corporate prayer, the Holy Spirit began to draw them. them together and knit their hearts and minds together. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all in common. In other words, it's like this. I can tell when I preached a good Holy Ghost sermon, because I'll look out and I'll see husbands and wives holding hands. I'll see them kind of squeeze each other. And when we get done at the service, everybody's lovey-dovey. Why? That's a presence in the love of God.
Yes. Right.
They said that's what happened here, that they corporately prayed. They were shaken. They got filled with the Spirit, filled with boldness. God drew them together, and they had this attitude. If you need something that I have, let me know it's yours.
Praise the Lord. That's beautiful. Bring it.
That's good stuff, isn't it?
Bring it. Amen.
So, Dad, I need fish. Alright, go one more. Go to 1 John 5:14.
1 John 5:14.
Do you like it this morning?
Amen.
I know it's not running, shouting, and exciting, but this is good nuts and bolts that will carry through years of your Christian life. 1 John 5:14. This will carry you through.
Awesome.
So we're gonna do a study. You guys are gonna do a little study on murmuring and complaint. Bible school. Listen, I had to learn it too, man. It's easy to get caught up in one thing and all of a sudden it's consumed 6 hours of your day.
Right.
Talking about that problem, that person, that situation. Just think, if we weren't doing that for 6 hours, we could be praying, praising, and helping somebody.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen.
No covenant.
1 John 5:14. It says, now listen, this is why we pray. And learn how to pray His Word and who God is. There are aspects of the Father. See that intimacy. There are things about me that only Kelly knows that none of you will ever know.
Yeah.
I mean, there's things that you guys, that she knows about me, and you better not tell anybody. But nobody knows why. And there's things about her. Why? Because we're intimate. See, when it's just me and her, I can run around in my boxers and watch TV and eat Cheetos and drink root beer. I can be who I am. I'm comfortable in her presence. You understand? To be undone. I don't have to be all dressed for show. But one of you knock on the door, guess what? I'm getting dressed. I'm putting away the Cheetos and I'm going to get myself presentable. But there are aspects about the Father that you will never, ever, never, ever get apart from intimate prayer.
Amen.
Never.
That's beautiful.
I remember I told you guys I locked myself away and I met the Lord in a real way. I met His presence. I have never been the same. Never.
Amen.
And there has been a hunger in me for the people of God to get together and pray.
Yes.
Listen, I told you I've been chasing, I'm on a quest, man, for real revival. We're going to experience here.
Yes. Amen.
But it won't happen apart from prayer.
Amen.
And praise.
Amen.
See, God's presence is ushered in on prayer and praise.
Yes.
See, we have good preaching here. We have good teaching. But listen, here's what I desire. The continual presence of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That will only happen through prayer and praise as a corporate body.
Yes.
Getting in one mind and one accord. That's the only way it works.
Right.
1 John 5:14, it said, this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us.
Amen.
That's good to know. God's listening.
Amen.
You remember that old commercial, E.F. Hutton? You youngsters don't remember that. And then when E.F. Hutton talked, people listened. God's listening to our heart. He's listening. He's attentive to you. I think that's one of the biggest things that blew me away as a young Christian, that God actually is listening to me.
Yeah.
When He hears me, He cares.
Yeah,
true.
It's awesome.
And that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Now look, here's where this will wipe out your worry. And if we know that He hears us, whatsoever we ask, underline that, circle it, put a star, get it tattooed on your arm, something. We know that if He hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions we have desired of Him.
That's it.
In other words, the Word of God promises you this. When you go to God with a pure heart, pure motive, and you know that He's listening, whatever you've asked, whatever you pray, it's yours, it's done.
Amen.
And that ought to just blow worry completely out of your life.
Hallelujah.
That ought to take murmuring and complaining away. Look, man, I just came from prayer meeting, and I asked for this, and I asked for that, and I met with God, so guess what? You guys watch out and watch what He's going to do in just a little while.
Amen.
Well, brother, now come on, you're getting way out there on a limb. Yeah, that's where all the right fruit is. For 20 years. I heard him preach one time when I was 16 years old, but because of the way I look, I mean, he was in Bible school, had a call to preach, had his books, and at that time, all his tapes, he was studying. I had come back, I'd been gone for a couple years. I got sent away because I needed to go somewhere, and then I came back and found out he had a call of God on his life to preach. And you understand, we weren't brought up in church, it was foreign to us. But something got a hold of him. And he said, "Will you come hear me tonight?" I said, "Yeah." But I went in and I sat at that church and I had earrings and, you know, I looked kind of rough. And everybody started moving away and talking. And my brother delivered his sermon. And then he went home and got his books and tapes. And he said, "If this is how the church treats people, I don't want to be a part of this garbage." I've been praying 20 years. Pick your call up, man. See, usually what God does, the call of God runs through the family.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
But I know that I will see it. Why? Because I've asked according to God's will.
Amen.
I've got my children back. I've got family back. I spent about 25 years without any family. And just the last year, 2 years, they've all been coming back, man, getting in contact. Why? Prayer. And I learned this as I matured, that just because I pray doesn't mean... Now listen, how many of you know God has a payday for you?
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
Paydays aren't Friday and noon.
Right.
Well, God, I pray Monday. It's Friday at 12 o'clock.
Right.
It doesn't work that way. Listen, the Bible says this. I had to get this down in my heart. Now, I don't like this. It says that a day is like 1,000 years to the Lord.
Yes.
I said, "Well, when are you going to do that?" He said, "Tomorrow." I said, "Wow." A day is like 1,000 years. In other words, God's time clock doesn't work like ours. It took a while for me to understand this. But there are times that Kelly and I thought we'd pray for stuff. It didn't come right then, but when it came, it was more needed than when we had prayed. And if we'd have got it when we prayed, we wouldn't have had it that next week to do what we needed to do for the kingdom.
That's
right.
Amen.
So rest assured in this, it's on its way, but it will get there at the right time, not when you demand God to give it to you.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, someone.
Oh, yeah.
Come on with it. Here's a mistake we make in prayer. Because we know who we are and our authority and power, we go to the throne and we stomp our feet and we demand, "God, you do this."
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, wait a minute. I already promised you I'd do it. But you don't make demands on me.
That's right.
You make requests of me and I will grant that.
Right.
And as you become intimate with me and your character becomes like my character, then I will give you all the things that I promised you, because then you won't squander it on yourself, you won't hurt people, you won't come full of pride, but you will use the things I give you to change lives.
Hallelujah. That's good.
There's corporate prayer, man. We need that. Yeah. Then, it says if we ask anything, Jude 20 says this, okay? This is the last thing. Getting late. It says, "But ye beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Let me quote that to you again, because it's been read and quoted wrong in the church world.
That's good.
They said, you build up your faith praying in the Holy Ghost. No, you don't. You build up your faith one way, Romans 10:17, so that faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. And I will tell you this so you don't get hurt feelings if you ever come up here and you say, Brother David, pray for me to have more faith. I won't pray for you to have more faith. I will pray that you get a hunger to search the Word of God, because in there is where faith is born. So Jude 20 says, but you, beloved, building yourselves up, praying in the Holy Ghost. As a New Testament church, there is an avenue of prayer that God has ordained, and is praying in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
A lot of denominations say, well, that's just inspired prayer with God. No, it's not. It's praying in an unknown tongue. That's what praying in the Holy Ghost is.
Amen.
Listen, those of you that are filled with the Holy Spirit, if you spend time praying in other tongues, it says you will build yourself up. That phrase build up could be a modern equivalent to you will get a charge on your battery.
Yes.
Now listen, let me tell you why Satan fights this so much. Those of you who have been around should understand by now. That when you're filled with the Spirit, it's taught a lot in a lot of Pentecostal circles that God can't understand praying in tongues. Now, we know now that's not correct. Amen?
Amen.
The devil can understand you when you pray in an unknown tongue. He speaks the tongue of men and he speaks the tongue of angels.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, yes.
The reason he doesn't want you to do it is found in Romans 8, chapters verses 26 and 27. It says this. That when we pray in an unknown tongue, number one, we pray the perfect will of God. And then when we're praying in unknown tongues, it says that we intercede for the saints according to the will of God. So it's not that the devil can't understand it, but he doesn't like it, because it is a prayer that is pure, it is holy, and it is motivated by God, and your mind is not in the way of it.
Amen.
And see, 1 John 5:14 says if we pray according to His will, we know He hears us. And if He hears us, He gives us what we ask. Romans chapter 8 says that when we pray in an unknown tongue, that we pray the perfect will of God. So listen, praying in an unknown tongue is the one prayer that will always come to pass.
Amen.
That's why Satan doesn't want that doctrine. That's why he fights that doctrine. I said, man, them people are nuts. You see how they act? Well, you get filled, you'll act nuts too. Why? Because something from another realm, something from the heavenly realm has invaded my flesh body. And sometimes I don't know how to act. Some this morning when you guys were here,
amen.
I didn't care. I felt like running, shouting, jumping, just joy.
I still feel it.
Yeah, it feels good in here. Don't tell me, go on.
No,
go eat. But listen, praying in other tongues, praying in the Holy Ghost, the reason there is so much argument and bickering about it in the church, because Satan is scared to death of people to get filled with the Spirit.
Yes, right?
Amen.
That's right.
Why? Because your whole life changes.
Yes.
Everything about the Lord changes.
Yes.
I'm convinced of this. That there was some old Pentecostal lady or man in this area praying for a Moses to come and deliver the people of God.
Yes.
I'm telling you, man, I should be dead. I should be in prison. This blows me away most Sundays when I'm here. I'm convinced that there was somebody praying in the Holy Ghost for me. And God had to put a fish hook in my mouth and drag me here to my destiny. I'm convinced that some of you, somebody has been praying,
amen,
interceding for the saints of God according to the perfect will of God, and here you are.
Hallelujah.
Now, they've helped get you in that plan. Now it's your job, through prayer and intimacy, to figure out that plan singly. And then as we gather together corporately, God will reveal His plan to our hearts. Listen, I don't run this church like a dictatorship, do I, Dad?
No.
The only one I mean to is you. But listen, I'm waiting for the day when we gather together and pray and the plan and the will of God. Man, that's what's happening. That's why we've got the children's church. Why we've got the food ministry. And we got recovery going again. The worship team has been prayed in. I told you, when we had that other storefront church, we would say, Lord, we thank you. We thank you that our worship team is here. Father, we thank you the bass player, the singers, the drummers, they're all here. We thank you. I'm looking for the day all of you get gripped with destiny in your heart and you figure out what it is you're supposed to do and what part you play here. If there's something that you can add to this place, tell me, please, tell me. My goal is not to just perform and everybody say how great I am, but my goal is to bring all of my spiritual children into their destiny. Amen. And that is the only way that this place will grow and flourish, is if I do my job correctly and love you through your garbage till you get to where you need to be.
Yes.
Amen. Prayer, prayer, prayer. Father, we thank you for your...